dependent origination or conditioned genesis, which is one of the Buddha's most important suttas. And we've been using this little picture to give us the outline of the Paticca-samuppada, and I think we got to this point, which has the monkey jumping from one tree to another, which is the relinking consciousness. Everybody see where we are? Anybody lost? So, the relinking consciousness is what sparks off a new life form. And so the link before that is the body and the mind, nama rupa, which is represented in the illustration by a boat and a boatman. The boat cannot go anywhere without the boatman cannot go anywhere without the boat. So they are interdependent. But to begin with, there has to be this re-linking consciousness to spark off the new life form. Unless this relinking consciousness is present, there will be no conception. So conception has to take place only when there is the relinking consciousness to energize the new form of life which is going to begin. So we've got, I think, we've got to paragraph 60. Yeah. Okay. Formations. Formations. The word is sankhara. If you look at that separate sheet I gave you with a chart on it, the different links of the Paticca-samuppada are listed there, and you will see sankhara is one of them. So if you'd like to read, please.
And what are formations? What is the origin of formations? What is the cessation of formation? What is the way leading to the cessation of formations? There are these three kinds of formation: the bodily formation, the verbal formation, the mental formation. With the arising of ignorance, there is the arising of formations. With the cessation of ignorance, there is the cessation of formations. The way leading to the cessation of formations is just this noble eightfold path, that is, right view, right concentration. When a noble disciple has thus understood formations, the origin of formations, the cessation of formations, and the way leading to the cessation of formations, he here and now makes an end of suffering. In that way too, a noble disciple is one of right view and has arrived at this true Dhamma.
So the word sankhara
means volitional actions which create karma. The Buddha has said that there are three kinds. There's the bodily, verbal, and mental. Karma is generated by any intentional act. And this can be a thought, it can be a word, or it can be a deed. Thoughts may generate karma. If you translate that thought into speech, that will be a stronger action. And if you translate that speech into bodily action, that is the strongest form of karma. They can be wholesome, volitional actions, or unwholesome volitional actions. If you want a good result, a beneficial result, then it's a wholesome action. If it's a wish to have some kind of harmful result, then it's an unskillful volitional action. And if you look at the chart, the picture, here on this drawing we have a potter making pots. And if you look carefully, you can see that some of the pots are good pots and some of the pots are broken or bad pots. In the same way, some of our volitional actions are good or wholesome and some are not good or unwholesome. Doesn't matter whether they're wholesome or unwholesome, they will still produce a karmic consequence. So the formations are the cause for consciousness to arise, whether they are wholesome or unwholesome. This works not only at the beginning of life, but also throughout life, that what we experience is the result of previous actions, actions of thought, word, and deed. Yes.
This isn't where the volition happens. It's back at the link between sensation and craving. This is just a foregone conclusion. What's going to happen?
Not entirely.
Take the case of someone nearing death. There arises in the mind either an action, the recollection of an action which has previously been performed, maybe a habitual action which has been performed during the life that is about to end. It can be a wholesome action, it can be an unwholesome action. That's one thing which can arise in the mind. Secondly, there can be an object connected with that action. So if you have been in the habit of offering flowers to an image of the Buddha, you might see flowers. If you've been a butcher, you might see the knife or the axe you've been using to cut up animals. The third thing that comes into the mind, or can come into the mind, is it's called the gati nimitta, the destination sign. It's a kind of a sneak preview of where the next life will take place. You might see a place of happiness, or what we might call a heaven. You might see a place of unhappiness, what we call a hell. And this may perhaps explain why some people die quite happily or relaxed. Other people die in a state of distress because they've had a look at what is coming up next. So this is responsible for the last thought moment of this particular life. We have the word chuti chitta, which is the death thought moment, and then we have the patisandhi chitta, which is the re-linking consciousness. So the subject taken up can vary depending on what is the last thought moment in the previous life. And that is generated. Actions are all generated by intentions. So this thought moment, the patisandhi chitta, is what has to be present for the conception to take place. If that is not present, there will be no conception. That is how the Abhidhamma explains death and rebirth. Once the relinking consciousness has done its work, then immediately following upon it, other mental factors and other physical qualities start to arise. And that then starts off the development of the fetus and eventually the birth of the new being. No, it happens at that time. If there is no relinking consciousness, then there will be no conception.
Okay, so they have to go hand in hand.
Exactly. And although that form of mentality precedes the arising of materiality of the body or the body factors, from that time onwards, the body and the mind are interdependent, as shown by the picture of the boat and the boatman, depending on each other. So from that moment onwards, consciousness depends on the body, and the body depends upon consciousness. And that mutual interdependence continues throughout the life. I think the technical term is reciprocal conascence, if you want to know the complicated word for it. The next link is ignorance, which we read about from paragraph 64.
Then they asked him a further question. But, friend, might there be another way in which a noble cycle is one of right views and has arrived at this true Dhamma? There might be, friends. When, friends, a noble disciple understands ignorance, the origin of ignorance, the cessation of ignorance, and the way leading to the cessation of ignorance, in that way he is one of right view and has arrived at this true Dhamma.
Here, Venerable Sariputta does something unusual.
You don't find in most of the other explanations of dependent origination. Usually, ignorance is said to arise due to the fact that the previous being died in a state of ignorance. If you look at the illustration, we have a blind person. Ignorance is arising, shown here, because of death. We die in a state of ignorance, and that means the whole cycle continues. But here, Venerable Sariputta, very unusually, he goes off in a different direction. He is now going to give us a cause for the arising of ignorance. So this is a very original insertion here by Venerable Sariputta. So if you'd like to read from 66, please.
And what is ignorance? What is the
ignorance? What is the cessation of ignorance? What is the way leading to the cessation of ignorance? Not knowing about suffering, not knowing about the origin of suffering, not knowing about the cessation of suffering, not knowing about the way leading to the cessation of suffering, this is called ignorance. With the arising of the taints, there is the arising of ignorance. with the cessation of taint, there is the cessation of ignorance.
Okay, so...
what is a taint?
A defilement.
The word is asava. I think you've got that word asava on that chart on the last page of the notes I gave you. you should have, I think, above the paticca samuppada, where it lists all the 16 examples that Sariputta is going to give. The last one is the taints or the asavas, the defilements. But before we get into that, there's an important point to try to take on board with reference to these 12 links on this circle. And that is that behind this, there's nothing else. You won't find a me or an I. You won't find a controller who's in charge of all this. All you can say is, independence on what does so-and-so arise? But there isn't a me who feels, there isn't a me who makes contact, there isn't a me who craves, there isn't a me behind all this. This is an impersonal process, and this is trying to help us to understand the Buddha's teaching of no self or no soul. He said there's nothing which is permanent, abiding in us, which could be called a self or a soul. Atman is the word that is used for a soul, and this is anatman or anatta. The anatta doctrine is one of the most important of the Buddha's teachings. And if you can look at this circle of these 12 links, if we look at it correctly, we see that there are just these links arising and passing away. There's nobody in charge of all this. Yes, so now we're going to branch off from that into the taints or toxins, they're sometimes called. And these, we shall see, are what gives rise to ignorance. But we'll find that one of these taints is ignorance. So, this is trying to show us that ignorance is both a cause and an effect. So, there is really no beginning to ignorance. If you say what gives rise to ignorance, it's the taints. Okay, but one of the taints is ignorance. So, we're in a little loop here, and there is no first cause. The Buddha's teachings do not posit a first cause. So we can't take ignorance as the beginning of all of our problems. It is a major contributor along with craving. But the beginning of ignorance is not to be found.
But isn't it that suffering is everywhere?
Yes.
So everybody, to some extent, is aware of suffering.
Right view comes in two levels. The mundane right view, which is trying to understand intellectually the Four Noble Truths. But the end of the path is supramundane right view, when we directly experience these Four Noble Truths. So you can take the understanding on two different planes, and right view, Sammaditthi, is the beginning and the end of the Noble Eightfold Path. Yes, if you look around us, most people will agree that there is suffering. But will they understand the cause? Will they understand the cessation? Will they understand the path leading to the cessation? Okay? Yes.
in Buddhism, there's no self. There's no notion of self. But if there's no self, how would you explain the individual karma and collective karma? Individual karma and someone's personal experience of suffering. If there's no individual self,
is a process that is continually flowing on and flowing on. It's not something permanent which then experiences certain things in the course of life or which performs certain actions in the course of one's life. We are simply a combination of physical properties and mental properties which are constantly arising and passing away. There's nothing lasting, even for as long as a finger snap. So we have constantly physical and mental qualities arising and passing away, arising and passing away. This is a very difficult concept for us to grasp because it runs contrary to our natural impulse, which is to think about me as a solidly existing being. But this is what the Buddha is trying to help us to understand, is that there is nothing behind this process. The process is constantly flowing on, like a river. It flows on and it flows on and it flows on. Physical and mental qualities arise, pass away, arise, pass away, arise, pass away. One analogy would be to say the analogy of going through a cinema in the days when film was shot on 35mm rolls of film. There's a series of little individual photographs. If you play them through the projector fast enough, you create an illusion on the screen that there is a person on the screen. A person who walks from here to there, a person who speaks, a person who runs or dies or flies or all sorts of things that the actor can do. But we can see through that. That is simply an illusion created by this sequence of individual frames played through the projector at a high speed. In a similar way, we are also a process of individual moments, but they arise and they pass away so quickly that we cannot break them down one by one by one. In a split second, millions of these individual moments arise and pass away. So it is creating in us this illusion of something which is lasting, something durable. But it is only an illusion.
Are we like a product of collective karmic consequence, or
I don't think Theravada Buddhism has a notion of collective karma. We each have our own individual karmic inheritance, depending on the volitional actions which we have performed in this life earlier and in lives previous to this one. Now,
we have to make... There's a self in a way, because you're responsible for your own action.
There's a continuity.
But there's not a self in the sense that there's something enduring. There's a sequence of individual events. The classic question is, you think of yourself today and you think of yourself at the age of 10 years, are you the same person that you were at the age of 10, or are you a completely different person? That's a, but the illusion is, it's an illusion of an enduring self. If you take physically, the body that you have today is connected to the body you had at the age of 10 by a process of cause and effect. Individual cells arise, others die, the body changes. It's not the same now as it was even a few seconds ago. There's constant change going on in the body. And in the same way, there is constant change going on in the mind, in the consciousness. You can't say that there is a totally different consciousness from the consciousness you had at the age of 10. But it's not the same. It's moved on. Going back to our analogy of the river flowing on. The Greek philosopher Heraclitus, he said, you cannot step twice into the same river. Meaning, if you step off the bank into the river, step back on the bank, and then step back into the river, that river has moved, it's flowed on. It's not the same river that it was a couple of seconds beforehand. It's a different river. Okay, it has the same name, but it's not the same river you're stepping into. On the second occasion, it's changed. So this idea of an enduring self is one of the most difficult things to understand properly. And the next sutta we're going to do, the Alagadupama Sutta, that has an extensive discussion by the Buddha on this particular subject. So perhaps we can wait until we get to that sutta. I think so. Well, you're now going to give us the explanation.
Taints. Saying, good friend, the bhikkhus delighted and rejoiced in the venerable Sariputta's words. Then they asked him a further question. But friend, might there be another way in which a noble disciple is one of right view, whose view is straight, and who has perfect confidence in the Dhamma and has arrived at this true Dhamma? There might be, friends. When friends, a noble disciple understands the taints, the origin of the taints, the cessation of the taints, and the way leading to the cessation of the taints, in that way he is one of right view, whose view is straight, who has perfect confidence in the Dhamma and has arrived at this true Dhamma. And what are the taints? What is the origin of the taints? What is the cessation of the taints? What is the way leading to the cessation of the taints? There are three taints: the taint of sensual desire, taint of being, and the taint of ignorance. With the arising of ignorance, there is the arising of the taints. With the cessation of ignorance, there is the cessation of the taints. The way leading to the cessation of the taints is just this noble eightfold path, that is, right view, right intention, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration. When a noble disciple has thus understood the taints, the origin of the taints, the cessation of the taints, and the way leading to the cessation of the taints, he entirely abandons the underlying tendency to lust. He abolishes the underlying tendency to aversion. He extirpates the underlying tendency to the view and conceit, I am. And by abandoning ignorance and arousing true knowledge, he here and now makes an end of suffering. In that way too, a noble disciple is one of right view, whose view is straight, who has perfect confidence in the Dhamma, and has arrived at his true Dhamma. That is what the Venerable Sariputta asked, said, the bhikkhus were satisfied and delighted in the Venerable Sariputta's words.
This is showing that there is no beginning to ignorance. It is not explained by the Buddha. Yes,
she's in chapter 70, the taint of being. I don't understand that. The taint of being.
The taints are sensual desire, kam asava. I think you've got that on that support sheet I gave 16. You. Have you still got that?
Yeah,
okay. You can see there that one is kamasava, the taint of sense desire. Then bhava, the taint of becoming. Think back to the second noble truth. The noble truth, the cause of suffering, is tanha. One form is kamatana, desire for sense pleasures. Then there's bhava, the desire to become, the desire to continue, the desire to go on. This is another form of tanha. So it's been described here as the taint of being, but becoming is another word for it. It's the desire that our life should continue, not stop now. Most people, if you say to them, life should stop now, they will say, no.
That is the desire to continue. It even manifests in the desire for some kind of eternal life. Some people hope that after death they will be transported to some kind of eternal happiness, to heaven, to paradise, however you like to describe it. This is also part of bhava, tanha. So that is a taint. And then there's avij asava, the taint of avidya, the taint of ignorance, non-understanding. Okay. So we've got the eradication of taints. The sotapanna, the stream enterer, eradicates diti, the fetter of diti, wrong view, which is in some cases is the fourth of the an extra asava. Then the anagami, the non-returner, he eradicates kama raga, is the term, but that is the same as kam asava, the desire for sense pleasures. And then the enlightened being, the arahant, eradicates avidya, ignorance, and bhava raga, the desire to become, bhava tanha. So these taints can be eradicated and indeed must be eradicated before enlightenment is eventually reached. And in 71, paragraph 71, we've got the underlying tendency, the anusaya. Lust, aversion, view, and conceit. So this is the end of Sariputta's explanation of right view, Sammaditthi. We might take a moment just to look at the rest of this diagram to explain to you what else is being shown here. If you look at the center of the wheel, you will see a pig, a cockerel, and a snake. These are the three fundamental defilements in the mind: lobha, dosa, and moha. Moha is ignorance. That's the pig. And you can see that the tail of the cockerel and the tail of the snake are both connected to the pig. That shows you that lobha and dosa cannot arise without ignorance being present. The pig is ignorance. The cockerel is greed, desire. And the snake, the poison of hatred and anger and ill will. Outside that center point, there is another little circle, half of which has a white background and half has a black background. This is illustrating four kinds of being. There are beings who are born in the dark. That's in the 1 o'clock position. And if you follow this round in a clockwise direction, they're staying in the dark. That means someone who is born in unhappy, unsatisfactory, disadvantageous conditions. Poverty, maybe a dysfunctional family, circumstances generally of disadvantage. And that person is remaining in the dark, meaning he is not able, not willing to rise above these unfortunate circumstances into which he's been born. But then the second kind of person is born in the dark and is going to the light. That's at 6, 7, 8 o'clock. That means a person is born again into unsatisfactory, unhappy conditions, but he rises above, starts off in happy circumstances, but he goes off the rails. He leads an unskillful life. And so he is going into the dark. Now, between that center circle and the 12 links of the Paticca Samuppada, we've got some of the planes of existence. Not all of them, but some of them. If you look, first of all, at the 9 o'clock or 8 o'clock position, you have a depiction of the animal realm, the animal world. This drawing has been done in the 20th century, so the one or two things you'll see there that wouldn't have been known at the time of the Buddha. For example, you've got somebody on the top of a hill with a gun shooting at some birds. You've got, looks like a lion jumping on the back of an antelope. You've got, looks like a maybe an oxen with a plow and somebody with a whip whipping the oxen. You've got a fishing rod to catch a fish. Lower down, you've got a big fish eating little fish. These are all examples of an unhappy, unsatisfactory existence. So that's the animal realm. If you go down to the 6 o'clock position, you'll see what is regarded as a hell realm. You've got, on the right side of it, you've got what looks like a railway line leading to a concentration camp. You've got, to the left of that, you've got various beings who are impaled on all sorts of stakes. You've got underneath that some giant bird devouring a human being, and then you've got huge maggots devouring other beings. I'm not sure what the bottom left one is, a man with a peaked cap. Looks like a, I don't know what it is, a frying pan. Anyway, these are places, the hell realms are places of unmitigated suffering and happiness. Moving anti-clockwise from there to the 4 o'clock position, we have the realm of the hungry ghosts, another place of unhappiness, depicted by beings who have huge bellies, huge hunger, huge thirst, but they have very, very thin necks, so they cannot possibly take in all the food and the drink they want to satisfy their appetites. Above them, we have at 2 o'clock, we have what are called demigods or titans. That's not actually too bad in existence. But there is a problem. There is a tree. The roots are in the demigods' realm. But you can see the right side of the tree has nothing but dead branches. Whereas the left side of the tree is bearing fruit. And that fruit is falling into the heavenly realms. And these are the deities living there. So the demigods are jealous of the gods, and that's why they have a cannon, and they want to make war on the gods. And then just to the left of 12 o'clock, of the 11 o'clock slot, you have the human plane. Human plane, you can see, is a mixture of happiness and unhappiness. You've got a bar, you've got a tank, you've got a baby's pram, you've got somebody bent over with old age. You've got both good things and bad things. You've got religious institutions, you've got a church and a mosque. So this is where the human plane is pictured. Now, leading out of this realm, you can see people who are able to hear the words of the Buddha. And they are climbing up an eightfold path, which takes them to enlightenment, to Nibbana. So Nibbana is not part of the realm we call samsara. All these other realms are part of samsara, the endless cycling along from one existence to another, sometimes happy states, sometimes unhappy states. Now you will see that this entire picture, this drawing, is held in the mouth of a demon. He is the demon of impermanence. And on his head there is a crown. Impermanence devours all worlds. So all of these planes or realms or worlds are impermanent. None of them lasts forever. And on his head, on the top of the crown, there are five skulls. Any guesses what the five skulls could be? Five? Not the precepts, no. The five khandhas, the five aggregates, form, feeling, perception, mental formations, and consciousness. And if you look down to the bottom of the picture, this samsara has a long tail, so long that you cannot see back to the start of the tail. The Buddha said that even he could not see back to the start of samsara. So, as best you can in a drawing, this is showing the length of samsara. See, this tail goes on and on and on. So that's the the five aggregates: form, feeling, perception, mental formations, and consciousness. Rupa, Vedana, Sanya, Sankara, Vijnana. Okay, any questions, any comments?
That is the only human realm where we have this possibility of phenomena.
Yes. That's why the Buddha said the human realm is the most important of the realms. In other realms, if they're places of unhappiness, you cannot hear and understand the Buddha's teachings. You could be born as a dog. We could have a dog sitting here now. But the dog will not understand anything to do with the Dhamma. So, if you're a dog, you cannot benefit from the Buddha's teachings. In the heavenly realms, life is so enjoyable there that you just want to spend all the time just lying around, enjoying yourself, relaxing, watching football, having a nice time. You have no incentive to do anything as far as your spiritual progress is concerned.
In a way, enlightenment is within the suffering, doesn't it?
No, enlightenment is outside. This is samsara here, and this is enlightenment up here. So it's outside samsara.
But without suffering, there wouldn't be enlightenment.
That is true, because in the human plane, we experience both suffering and happiness, which act like the carrot and the stick. The carrot is happiness. We know happiness and we want more happiness. So that gives us an incentive to work towards what the Buddha said is the highest happiness, that is enlightenment. But also we have the stick. We know unhappiness, we know suffering, and that is what makes us want to get out of the mess. So we have both an incentive and a kick up the backside to make us do something. That's why the human plane is such an important plane. It's a perfectly legitimate question to ask. We've had this with any kind of disaster. Why do some people survive? Some people don't survive. I think it is the explanation is that the individual karma of a number of individuals happened to ripen at that particular time. But I don't think we can talk about a collective karma that, I don't know, as a nation we have developed some sort of karma, because the nation is simply a collection of individuals. And I think the karma is an individual attribute. It's not something which is done on a nationwide basis or a group-wide basis. But the Buddha didn't say that everything happens due to karma. There are other causes at work. And in the Girimananda Sutta, there is this monk, Girimananda, who is sick. And the question comes up, why is he sick? Is it due to karma? And the Buddha says, no, it's not always due to karma. You can fall sick due to things like unaccustomed activity. So if you're not used to doing any physical activity and you start to dig your garden very vigorously and then the next day you have a pain in your back, that is not due to karma, it is due to unaccustomed activity. It can be caused by a change in the seasons. I forget one or two other explanations.
There are environmental factors which contribute.
Yes, and that's nothing to do with karma. So karma explains a lot of things, but it doesn't explain everything. You know, there are these five niyama. I don't know if you've heard of the word niyama. Five natural laws. The first is the physical inorganic order. These are the laws which explain phenomena like the passing of the seasons, like wind or rain. Then there's order of the seeds, the bija niyama. That's the laws of genetics. When you plant a carrot seed, you get a carrot, you don't get an apple tree. Karma has nothing to say on that at all. Then there's kama niyama, and then there's citta niyama, which is the laws, psychological laws, which explain the operating of the mind, how the mind works. And then the last is Dhamma Niyama, which is explaining certain things like gravity and certain phenomena which arise at the birth and the passing away of a Buddha. In the Parinibbana Sutta, at the time of the Buddha's death, there are thunderclaps and the world shakes and things like that, and also the trees come into bloom out of season. That would be attributable to Dhamma, Niyama. So karma is important, but it's not the sole explanation for everything.
So what happens, for example, I have two children.
Yes.
One has special needs.
Yes.
And is a lot of work.
Yes.
Has a more difficult life.
Yes.
The other one is touched with some form of growth. Everything is easy and comes yes. easy.
Yes.
Yes. He has a very positive relationship with everybody. Is it their karma that's brought them to me, or my karma that's brought them to me?
I've got to be careful because in the 1990s there was a manager in the England football team who, I don't know why he chose to say this because it's nothing to do with football, but he said that disabled people, it's their problem because of the way they've lived their lives in a previous life. This brought down the whole establishment on his head, and he had to resign as football manager. What's his name? Was it Hoddle? Yes. I think Glenn Hoddle. What he omitted to say was that just because somebody is the recipient of some unhappy karma, it doesn't mean to say we don't feel compassion for that person. So we should be compassionate towards all beings, and certainly those who are suffering in one way or another. We don't just say, well, that's your fault, you stewing your own juice, I don't care. And providing you show compassion, loving kindness. Wow. Now you see, is this a group karma or is this individual karma that tonight you've got cake instead of a mere biscuit?